also need to read some bans of marriage. And I publish the bans of marriage between Gary Frank Piper of this parish and Kay Vanessa Austin of the parish of St. John the Evangelist of East Hull. This is for the third time of asking. And if any of you know any reason in law why they may not have each other, you are to declare it. Heavenly Father, we pray for both Gary and Kay and for others who may be preparing for marriage at this time, either here or in other places. And we pray for them in their time of preparation and for their future together, that you will bless their marriages and their intention to make their promises before you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So from our service sheet, God has gone up with a shout.
The Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
The sun now is crowned with many moons. So in this time of penitence, of risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. In your mercy, forgive us.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We have lived by the light of our own eyes as faithless and not believing. In your mercy, forgive us.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We have lived for this world alone and doubted our hope in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us.
Lord, hear us.
And so may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
From the collect for the Sunday after Ascension, risen, ascended Lord, as we rejoice at your triumph, fill your church on earth with power and compassion, that all who are estranged by sin may find forgiveness and know your peace, to the glory of God the Father.
his way. Therefore, the righteous shall not be able to stand in the judgment, nor the sinner in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish.
Thank you. We've got a song now which particularly involves everybody. Thank you, Lord, for this fine day. Now, we can't really sing it, unfortunately. It's pretty tricky. But we can suggest maybe any prayers or thanks which we include. Now, we often say, thank you, Lord, for friends and family, which I think is one we often say. Is there anything else that anyone can think of that they particularly want to say thank you for this morning?
For my health.
For my health?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's say thank you, Lord, for the health and strength. Thank you. Yeah, we need some musicians to help us.
Chocolate.
For chocolate cake. Lord, for chocolate cake. I think we'll do that. What we'll do. We'll do thank you, Lord, for this fine day. I think we'll do chocolate cake in the middle. And then we'll do for our health and strength. For health and strength, and then for friends and family. And are there actions or are there not? Now let's just
Yes.
If you want, and arm your breath. Okay. For chocolate cake. For health and strength, for friends and family. So it's just four persons.
And guys, you're all going to get up and you're going to clap together. We're going to come sing, but let's clap. Come on.
I suggest we all stand, because we're all going to be standing for the gospel reading afterwards. So let's all stand.
Yeah. And then we can have this clap.
And in our hearts and minds, praise God.
kids, so that's positive. And we'll be doing various things. The children have got the app now, so that's brilliant. And at the back of the church, as you go out, please do take one of these if you didn't receive of them in your mailing, or you wanted, because of it was colour, you might have printed it out. But this is just a prayer resource for tomorrow, because tomorrow we're having a day of prayer as a church, and some people have pledged to pray from a certain time to a certain time. This might just help you. We are still missing a chunk in the late afternoon and early evening, if anybody wants to say that they're praying for some time then, or we should be all praying during the day anyway, but can you use this as your resource? For some reason, when it's printed, you have to do that. But never mind, that's another thing just to help you. So we're going to be using that as well. Now, what's the most precious thing in your life? Your legs. Wasn't quite what I was thinking of, but that's a good answer, Liz. Our legs. Because if you didn't have a legs, you wouldn't be able to walk. What's the most precious thing in your life?
My
wife. Your wife. Oh, that's lovely.
Children.
Yes. Your children.
Yes.
Your children. Most precious thing. Okay. So, if you were going away and, if you were going away and you weren't going to be around, what would you do to make sure that the most precious thing in your life was going to be looked after?
I mean, that would be a blessing a couple of days without them, but I'll make sure.
Okay.
But I'll make sure they are staying with someone we can trust.
So, yeah. So we'd do that, wouldn't we? We'd make sure that they were safe. We'd make sure that they were safe, that they were going to be cared for and nurtured during the time when you were away. And if you had something like a precious jewel, of us who've got these amazing rings that are worth millions. I'm sure you all like that, aren't you, in this church? But anyway, yeah. If you had, you'd probably have it in a safe, wouldn't you? To make sure that things are kept safe while you're away. Well, I start with that because it's in this vein that, as Paul said, Jesus here prays for his disciples as he prepares to go away. Himself. And it's just yet another indication that his death, his crucifixion, his resurrection, his ascension, and then, which we celebrated last Thursday, was clearly part of a plan, as he knows that his disciples are going to need to care. It wasn't an accident. He knew it was going to happen, so he was praying for the care of his disciples. So here we have Jesus entrusting those he loves and those who have walked with him in his way to God himself. He cares deeply for them and wants them to be protected spiritually and to continue their journey without him physically beside them as they walk his way. It's a wonderful, if not somewhat difficult, as I think you probably would have found, prayer to understand. But he sees them, it's clear that he sees them as being what the word sanctified, which means to be made holy by continuing God's word of truth. And we know from history that for most of the time that happened, after Jesus' ascension, we see the coming of the Holy Spirit, which will be you learn something new today. The names of the first followers of Christ, of Jesus, were called followers of the
way.
Followers of the way. Do you know why? Because Jesus himself said, I am
the way.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. And the way was the way of life that Jesus had lived. The way of life that embodied the purposes of God himself, that made the words of God come to life in how he lived and what he said. And as we look at this passage from John's Gospel, we can ask ourselves the question, what can we do to continue, like these disciples, to follow the way of Christ so that we can make a difference in our world today? After they'd been called followers of the way for a little while, do you know what they became then? What they were called then? They were called little Christs. Did you know that? And from that came the word Christian. Why were they called little Christs? Because they so embodied the word of following the way that Jesus thought, that's just like Jesus. So we're going to call them little Christs. I love that. I think that's a really beautiful summary of what we need to be like if we follow Jesus. So how can we do that? How can we really get to grips with following Jesus like those disciples? I think it's really helpful to go back to the psalm we've had so that we can learn, and I think we can learn so much from that, about being rooted in our faith, so that we can know the right way to go. So if you have, you might want to have a look at the psalm I've got it in front of you. And firstly, the Hebrew word that is translated here as blessed, I've never learned Hebrew, so I can't say what it is to you, but the Hebrew word that is translated as blessed could also be translated as contented. And if we think of the word contentment, contentment is something really deep, isn't it? It's something that comes from a really deep sense of peace. And so the psalmist is writing, contented, you know, at peace are those who do this and the other. And that's really important because here there's a contrast between almost between two different ways to live. Those that delight in God's word and live contented lives, and those who the psalmist calls as wicked. And wicked often these days is seen as wicked, isn't it? So it's a positive word, but actually in this sense it's not seen as a positive word. And whose lives are seen as empty, and they're like the chaff that the wind blows away easily. So what does the wicked refer to here? It's a word that actually is steeped in meaning, isn't it? And basically the psalmist writes, these are the people who aren't following God's way. They've rejected him and they want to live life live their lives based on other things that they think are important. And they've mapped out their life that way. So there's a huge contrast here between those who follow God's word, God's way, and those who don't. And one commentator writes this, which I think is really helpful. It says, doom is not a punishment any more than the happiness of the righteous is a reward. Each is a result of the natural outcome of a way of life which has been chosen. In other words, Psalm 1 says that when you walk up on the map outlined in the Bible, you're blessed. When you walk off that map, the result is you dry up and blown away. But rather than thinking about the wicked, I want us to think clearly about those in Psalms refers to who are blessed and righteous because they follow the word of God. Now he gives the image of a plant, a tree, planted by a stream. And in my mind, when I see that, what do you think I see? A big willow. A great big enormous willow tree with its roots well down in the stream. But what else I see, and this might not surprise some of you, is did you know that grapevines
8 and 9, 10,
something around that. Sorry? About a two-story building, thank you. Because I'm conscious that we've got old money and new money in this thing. So actually, if you think of a grapevine, which is probably only about so high, its roots could be possibly as tall as this roof. And why? Because they need to get their roots down to get moisture, but also to get the nutrients, and it's the nutrients that they get that give the flavour to the grapes, which makes a fine wine. Hence, I know about these things. But the question for us is, how far down are our roots? How can we make our roots go a little further down to be so rooted in God that we'll be able to truly bless ourselves and bring blessing to other people? And I think he gives us some ideas here. Firstly, it talks of who influences us. So it says, do we linger with sinners and sit in the assembly of the scornful? Or as the Message Bible translates it, you don't hang out at Sin Saloon, you don't slink along Dead End Road, you don't go to Smart Mouth College. Or as I might translate it, if you don't hang out with those who are going to lead you to do the wrong thing, you don't spend time with those who mock God's word or who gossip about others. If we want to get our roots deep down in God, then we need to allow God's word to influence us. His word must be a priority in our lives. And to do this, sometimes we have to shy away from others who are going to lead by their behaviour or their words and lead us to not very good places. If we want to get our roots deep down in God, then we probably need to take guidance not only from God, but from God's word, but be influenced by others who follow it too. So that's clear, I think. The first thing we need to do is be aware of what influences are in our lives. And then secondly, we're told to meditate on God's word. And when I think of the word meditate, I might think of somebody with their legs crossed going, or something like that. But that's not the picture that this word meditate is meant to conjure. The word meditate means, in scripture, means muttering. And in scripture, it's also used to describe a dove cooing or a lion roaring. So the word meditate is a repetition of God's word, knowing it and knowing that it gently encourages us and coos like a dove, like in Psalm 23, the Lord's my shepherd. That's a gentle word, isn't it? Or when it roars like a lion, like in Psalm 22, when the psalmist says, my God, why have you forsaken me? So as we meditate or mutter on God's word and learn more about it, then our roots get deeper, and we're able to discern God's will in our lives. Paul writes in the book of Romans, chapter 12, do not conform to the pattern of this world, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, perfect, and pleasing will. So just as Jesus prayed for his disciples to be sanctified by his word, this is his desire for us too, so that we can be transformed to know and to do his will and to walk in his way. And to do this requires us to spend time meditating on God's word of truth, allowing this to change us so that we can be transformed and then able to be people of discernment living out his will in our lives. And if we do this, then the psalmist writes, we will be blessed, we will be truly content, that deep-seated contentment. And we'll also be people that are able to pour out God's blessings on others too. Amen.
Amen. ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please sit. Thank you.
mentally fragile, the lonely, and all who care and trying to improve their lives. Four rounds of acts of kindness. When we feel afraid that we are unable to contribute to our local community, show us the way. Lord, we dwell in your perfect love.
right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus, the King of glory. Born of a woman, he came to the rescue of our human race. Dying for us, he trampled death and conquered sin. By the glory of his resurrection, he opened the way to life eternal, and by his ascension gave us the sure hope that where he is, we may also be. Therefore, the universe resounds with Easter joy, and with choirs of angels we sing forever to your praise. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. Signs of faith and words of hope. He touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body, given for you all." Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, "This is my blood, shed for you all, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
This is our song.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. This is our story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Send your spirit upon us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. So as our Father taught us, so our Saviour taught us, we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. Lord, we died with you on the cross.
Now we are raised to new life.
We were buried in your tomb.
Now we share in your resurrection. Live in us that we may live in you.
Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us pray.
Your seats to the right, because the music really goes. say is, if you'd like to be seated for the moment and then come forward, please. Let's say together the prayer after communion. Almighty God, Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and your glory. Amen. We shall conclude with the hymn, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you.